Welcome to our hydraulic planning advisory panel. My name is Craig Eddy. I facilitate the proceedings. We think this will be our last meeting, but we don't know that for sure until we get to the end of this one. As we normally do, let's go around the table and introduce the panel members, and then we'll get the technical stuff. Diane?
Dr. Theo Elmont, County Board Supervisor.
I am not Chip Boyle, Jacob Sumpel, lead transportation planner at TJPMC.
Morgan Butler, Southern Environmental.
Kathy Galvin, Charleston City Council.
I like to give my MGA a CRS out.
Tony Edwards, City of Charleston, India.
Okay. Technical Jared?
Charleston.
Chuck Proctor, Public Commission, planning to do that.
Anthony Donald with Parker Baker.
Ron Sander, VDI, Charleston.
Okay, and so through that, we have about 30 views on YouTube from our last meeting, which is a little overkill. No feedback from a couple different sources. This is what we left off the last meeting with. We revised some concept drawings for scenario one to show sidewalks along the US 21 bridge, which has been done, and you'll see that on the agenda I've been before, which is now. So, Paul, you want to fill us in on what we've done since the last meeting in addition to modifying that one graphic?
Okay.
We apologize for eating while you're.
No, we expected that. That's why we got up there early. So,
maybe it'll be the most question.
So, this will be this.
You'll hear snoring.
This will be a tag team effort like we've done before. So, yes, we do have some updated drawings that will show off, and they're really brand new. I mean, it was this morning. That's when they came to the ink dry, and we sent them to Hal. So, you probably haven't had a chance to see them unless you've been looking through the papers. So, the transit agencies, I'll let Anthony talk about this in a few minutes, but we did just hear back this morning from, and basically I'll steal your thunder, but they said, we think your concept is great, we can back into that, we can work with that. So, but we'll expand on that a little bit more. Complete draft report, yes, that's another item for us to talk about today is the draft report, not in detail, but in just in big picture context. And we have gotten some comments, some email comments, so thank you for those. And so let's dive in. So, you know, you've seen over the months lots of different drawings that we've talked about of the proposal that we all put together. But, you know, with something like this, at a conceptual level, you can continue, given more time, you continue to polish that coin and think of little things, and that's really what we've done. We haven't changed anything around the center, around the big intersection, but we've done some, we further clarified our best guess. Remember, this is conceptual of what some of the outlying areas would look like Zand Road, like Angus. So that's really what changed the most in this sketch. And we'll end up zooming in on these two ends, the north and the south end, in slides that follow. But this is an overall picture. So just a little more detail about what exactly could happen, not will happen, what could happen at Angus, what could happen at Zand. You know, this whole process we've been in is, I think, very well developed. There are a lot of smart scale applications being finalized this week across the state that don't have nearly this level of thought going into them. I've heard that over and over from other people. So we've come up with some concepts that you haven't seen before at the north and the south end. It's still consistent with what we all agreed to, but we came up with some ideas of how it might fit. And that will still change. It will, not it might change, it will change in design. This is conceptual level work. When a project is funded and goes to design, there's so much detail, ground survey and three-dimensional modeling of the roadways and property impacts measured to the, you know, to the half a foot. So this is just, unless we make some changes as a result of this meeting, this is a great proof of concept for the purpose of what we've done. And then I'll be dying to know what a big engineering construction entity maybe a public-private partnership does, but that's, they might make some tweaks here and there, even though the overall concept is the same. So this is, I'll let you speak about a couple of any noteworthy things in the Zoom areas.
Sure.
Like I said, in the main crossing there, pretty much the same that you've seen before. You see different colors that show up in the legend in the following slides about what is reserved for bike, pedestrian, and sidewalk. So here's a zoom in. This is a zoom in on the, let's call it the big intersection. So has anything changed on this? It has not since the last time.
We did update from the feedback, adding in these accommodations along 29 that were previously mentioned but hadn't shown. Those are now all pieced together so that everybody can see exactly what kind of paths would take around the intersection if you were put. But that is really the only change to the picture.
So if you haven't committed it to memory, it's a lot to absorb. So whether you have questions immediately or in 10 minutes, either one is fine about this particular frame. I think the other two frames are the ones that are worthy of more discussion because they have some new ideas. Same concept, same access, just how might it fit? This is one way the Angus Road crossing could fit. So anytime you build something that takes space, you have to make hard decisions. I'm going to hurt this person and not hurt that person. I'm going to hurt them both a little bit. Whatever. There will have to be, when this is designed, this is not designed, when this is designed, there will have to be some hard decisions. Does the designer focus all their impacts on one side or split the difference or what do they do? This is kind of an idea to focus, try to save the hotel and this quadrant more so. That's why you see a curve that could be done differently. It could all be to the south. It could all be to the north. It could be straight across. We don't need to have all that information right now for the purpose of what we've done, but this is an idea. So I want to add a couple of things.
Sure. Keeping with what we mentioned before, the elements of Zan Road, there is a travel lane in each direction, and adjacent to that travel lane is a 6-foot bike lane. And then outside of that is a 5-foot sidewalk. So that gets us all three of our modes across. And then we tee into the relocated ramps for westbound 250. And then that continues onto the Hillsdale extension that previously we kind of lopped off the south portion of the Hillsdale roundabout. Our connections to and from 29 are on the northbound side. We have dedicated lanes off and then onto 29. Then heading southbound, we drop a lane here, and then that is a yield condition on this side to get onto Angus. Then it's just a nice ramp here to connect on to southbound.
So keep in mind, this is kind of an orange color. These are two different grades, right?
Yes.
So this is below. This is at the current earth level right here. This is up high, just going across. So that's part of the reason why there's a little distance here. It would need to be some type of retaining wall or something, because they'd be getting further and further from one another as you cross.
It also illustrates what we've been talking about for a long time, the right turn access only onto and off of Angus here. But in order to get that to fit, you see the longer ramp needed between the grades and the difference in the elevation. We haven't really considered that until now.
Until you lay it out.
Yeah, so you see how early you have to get make your decision to get on that right.
And turn an example, when property impacts become super sensitive, even more so than now, there are things that could be done. This ramp could come down here and be more of a tight turn, a lower speed turn, could be more of an intersection. So those are some things that that's the type of thing you do, mitigation ideas when something's under design and trying to maintain control costs. But we wanted to just put that out there to not start with the most leanest minimum design. We want to start with a more robust design and let it develop.
Anything else on this?
Now, again, even sitting in this room before we started the presentation, already we could sit around here and think of other things. We could do this, we could move this ramp a little bit up here. That's normal, that's okay. Joel said, he's gone out somewhere, you know, he said maybe this would be more of a straight shot and then a kink, straight kink instead of a curve. Mm-hmm. Curved bridges are expensive and they're more complicated. So, but all of that, it's okay. That's the type of thing that the designers would figure out, where the piers end up dropping and things like that. Anything else on this one before I go on? Okay. All right, this is up at Zane. So I'll just, like you did in the last one, kind of build up the cross section of what's there.
Yeah, so the crossing here at Zane connects the new roundabout on Hillsdale across 29 to that complete the four-lane intersection at the district. The cross section to that, again, we have a travel lane in each direction. Adjacent to that is a 6-foot bike lane. And then the outside is actually an 8-foot sidewalk instead of a 5-foot. Now it's trying to keep with the vision that was included in the land use plan with having space for benches or landscaping. It'll say 8-foot sidewalk, and that's really just make sure we have the space to include some of the other elements that are not. It's really hard to put tiny little trees when you see those hanging out there. So try to reserve that space and make sure that it's included.
What else? Diantha, does this? I know a month or two ago we went around and around about. Where should that, how does that strike you as a crossing location compared to?
I think that looks like it's running right along the back parking lot on the line. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what North of Grumman and Stonefield wanted.
That's what I was asking.
Exactly.
Okay.
And in fact, North of Grumman was excited about that.
Okay.
Because it works for their employees as well.
So in real world, of course, this would be grade separated starting, I don't know, somewhere. It would start to go up.
Right.
What do you think?
We'd probably start building up and then start there and then the above the city.
Somewhere. So then by the time it touches down to the same grade as the parking lot, maybe, here. So of course, the question will come, and we don't have to figure it out now. But the question will come, hey, what about a curb cut here and a curb cut here? Those are all those little things that but we do want to keep that slow, traffic calming. We don't want to give people treating it like a drag strip. So maybe some curb cuts would help to kind of cool everyone down.
Mm-hmm. And it could be following the line of the street network that Stonefield started.
Right.
And my assumption too is we're going to want transit.
There you go.
So
maybe some pull-outs.
We may want some pull-ins, pull-outs, whatever you do.
Yep.
Yeah.
So
connect the two sides.
So those type of finishes absolutely would be during design. Absolutely. So let's see, anything else?
One thing we did talk about was that the elevation between the North Carolina and the Stonefield side of that bridge might allow the North Carolina side some parking underneath. Mark was talking about that at one point. And I can't tell the elevation.
We don't really have good enough elevation data to make determinations about that. That would be something they start to look at.
But we'd be at parking level, what do you think?
Here?
So I don't know.
I'm actually not sure about that.
Yeah.
I remember when we were doing some different work with this. That side is actually considerably lower than we are over here, and getting up and then to head back down.
Yeah.
You've got to kind of press a little
bit. Maybe an opportunity to use to save some parking underneath the ground.
Yeah. So if the piers were here. Here, that space doesn't necessarily have to be just that's basically the part.
How about on the other side too, you're gonna have to start elevating, and then it looks like you're gonna have to be giving up right away and acquiring the right of way.
Yeah, to help smooth out the grade out the curves, but how it lined up, but theoretically this. And what happens has to be maintained only here.
So all those little ideas, because theoretically that.
Yeah, that could still happen.
That could stay and only get to the first entrance stop. So the idea was just to get some really good looking drawings that try to answer as many questions as possible, knowing that it's normal for there to be debate and value decisions to be made years into the future before something is built. But I think this makes for a nice submittal. Okay. The report. So I sent out the report. Craig was, I think, on vacation and so on his behalf. And I sent out the draft report for all of this work to everybody. I hope everyone got it. I was using an older email. I just replied to all. So we got a couple of emails back, but nothing had really struck the boat. It was very intelligent, rational responses that I got. So we have a little punch list going. Nothing that really is dramatic of things that we'll do. So we didn't intend to go through the report sentence by sentence here today, but I thought Craig may kind of go around the room and just ask for
Rather than taking it page by page or section by section, I just thought we'd go around the table with family members, for those of you that have been able to invest some time to look at it, and just offer up your overall impressions and so forth. So I don't want to put anybody on the spot, so I won't call on everybody, but if you have looked at it, we'd like to share comments about your broad brush impressions of things. Are we on target? Does this, encapsulate what we've been trying to do and so forth? So I'll just open up the floor for comments and hear what you have to say. Because as Paul mentioned, we got very few substantive comments, about major redoing. There was wording changes and some sequential changes in that, but nothing personal. But anybody care to comment on the overall impression?
Two comments. One I sent to Paul, one word that I thought should go on page one. But on page 15, when you talk about the project screening and selection, you talk about the neighborhood needs, I don't think I see any mention in there about the small neighborhood needs. For instance, there were at least two or three for the Meadowbrook folks, and I thought there was another one. I thought there were some other meetings besides these major ones that are referenced in the paragraph, and I think it would be helpful to
Great, great comment, and you're in good company. We also had a comment from another panel member, so I agree with that.
And then the only other comment I have, and this is something that sort of sales pitch. One of the things we're trying to do is to sell Lynchburg, Mandel, Culpeper, Warrington on this thing. Focus on how much quicker they're going to be able to get through Charlottesville as a result of this, maybe tied into the drive with Great Sepulveda Interchange, where it used to take 12 minutes to get from the bypass to Lowe's. Now it's going to take 4 minutes or 5 minutes.
All right, that's good.
Are you referring to, like, as part of what are as a plan to follow up?
I think I'll read, if this is a sales tool, this is what goes in with the application.
I think we have that. We have the travel time data, right, with and without.
I think we and Chuck, and I agree with your other point too, that providing more detail on this smaller meetings, I think, is a great idea. But I think this kind of emphasizing a bit more a couple of tables in there that show the no build versus.
Yes.
And, you know, there's a table there, some people may just gloss over that, including in the text. Every single one of these sentences is written by at least 50% or, you know, something along those lines, really just.
I agree.
Brings it home.
Well, D to C on the table.
Yeah.
Only shows a savings of about 3.5 minutes. Which would sound like 3 minutes. This is on page 17. If I'm looking at the right thing. D to C, which is the Lynchburg through traffic. In the morning would say 3.5 minutes, in the afternoon would say 4 minutes. I don't know how big of an issue that is, but if you combine that with the right of way separate interchange, I guess it is you're up to almost 10 minute change.
Well, the other way to present it is that a no build, you take you twice as long in the morning, in the afternoon you take it 3 times.
Yeah. That, and that, because they're all, that's more dramatic.
That's a better way to say it.
Yeah, just kind of look at it.
Cut the time in half.
It cuts the time travel time in half in the morning, it cuts it by two-thirds.
Rather than worrying about the four.
Yeah, I agree with that, that's.
Yeah, you don't want to get into, think about the minutes.
Hey, Chuck, it's B to C, not.
Say it again.
It's B to C. It would be the point that you're looking at.
Well, that's better.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I understand what you're talking about, that will affect the folks from Lynchburg. Because that's the 2 minutes.
That's a third. I mean, you have 2/3 of that one.
Yeah.
In stressing how that, I think Chuck is really right, in stressing how this intersection works with the other one.
Okay.
Because without a doubt, this really frees up the whole corridor.
So we're looking at the travel times, what it is right now.
Right.
And it's not going all the way through the corridor, it's just going through this little piece of it.
Right. So without building no or without any change to the hydraulic intersection, all that work at Rio, while it's good, it's really not.
Yeah.
Is there a way to look at what the travel times were before Rio and add them to the travel times in a no-build situation here, and then after Rio and then after building this, and you really get the combined impacts of before and after?
We've got analysis of before and after Rio real time.
That's interesting.
Then you'd see the real impact.
We're talking about the corridor.
Yeah.
How would we put
that
into
the corridor? We could be talking about 15, 20 minutes.
That's right.
Maybe we don't build it into the table, but it could be an extra statement.
Yeah.
By the way.
These combined with Rio have improved travel time by so many minutes.
The last 5 years. Well, it seems like forever, doesn't it? It does
seem like
it does. The B to C movement, pick up Chuck's point, cuts 2/3 off of the AM video. I'm not here. Yeah, so we've got to be prepared for it.
But, well, we've got to equip her with the verbiage she needs to implement this.
In some ways, Rio is not able to fully soar because you've got this intersection. So you can't exploit the true benefit of that.
There it is.
Until this is.
Yeah, that's better language than I was saying. I was just talking about how it makes the whole corridor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's very poetic.
Yes, he was.
Sucks!
Okay. I'll only put it all
for an engineer, I'm impressed. I get to say that.
Well, can you all find some way to put that in here and send it to us in red line to look at for 5 months?
Yep. I have a couple of comments. I sent them to Paul yesterday. And overall, I thought y'all did a great job and very appreciative of the work you put into this. My comments are a couple of places where I thought we could mention transit one or more times.
Yeah. That's good.
Like there was a factor that we considered. Same point that Chuck made about where we do summarize the public meetings. I think there are only the 3 big ones that were mentioned, but as I recall, there are a number of smaller ones.
The Meadows, we went to Mickey Drive,
Yeah.
I don't think we have to have a misstatement under this.
No.
We're just saying, in addition to.
To make sure that the outreach is done to the communities and all around.
Does anyone in the room have a great list of that?
Chip, yeah.
Chip has it.
Okay.
Chip Pleasant.
Chip's a surrogate here.
This is pretty minor, but there's one where we summarized Angus, and I made a similar comment back on the meeting materials for the public meeting. When we do the one sentence summary of Angus, I think we should also highlight that it's a pedestrian and bike components as well as the particular, because that's been such a big emphasis. There's a point in here where it talks about what this panel based its decision on between the three alternatives, and it says public input was a big factor. I think it'd be helpful, and it points out that the public was in favor of the options like it. Because I recall the public was overwhelmingly in favor of that. It was like 24 to 4 to 4, and then all the additional ones that came in after that tally were all in support of. That's, I mean, I don't need any precise numbers, but just something.
Again, percentages.
Just how strongly the public supported. Because I remember that did have a big impact on us.
Yeah.
And I think those are the summary of what I shared.
Yeah, something I'd like to add is when I sent this out to everybody with my email, whatever that was last week, I wrote in there, you may not have seen it, but I like the public meeting, like taking credit for the public meetings. I think it also would be good to state any resolution or board or council support that was maybe acquired.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, but I think we're silent about it, so we should say it and take credit for it.
Yeah, yeah, both planning commissions and both board and council endorse this 100%.
No one else would identify the joint city county planning commission workshop.
That's right.
And they have to do that in every city. And the engagement process is pretty,
yeah.
It's really,
yeah, so beefing up that the joint jurisdictional
partnerships
and the working, yeah, that this really demonstrated that ability.
Some of the things, Alex, if I could go to that other part where we're summarizing the public outreach, those are good points. It wasn't just the labor meetings, there were a number of joint official meetings that I could have taken.
Very good.
I would just make one final comment for the locals who've been around here a while.
Yep.
Tim Lynch from wherever he is, and Charlotte Humphreys are smiling down like.
Oh, you. My goodness, yes.
George Larry, he would like to live another 2 weeks.
Yeah. I did a lot of good work and had a vision, and it's neat to see what's.
Hey, political persuasion.
That was also cheap.
Election demand.
Oh, yes, they do.
Any other?
There were no surprises in any of the content. I mean, it was all stuff that we've been living with for over a year.
Yeah, and I like the focus on. The emphasis, you know, to bring out the story and tell the bigger tales and make sure that we sell it. So there's some salesmanship involved we can do. I mean, after all, we are competing, you know, for funding.
Yeah.
Better the story, better chances. So,
and there's good comments. If we get to the end of this upcoming round of Smart Scale, and we have a concern that because it's such a competitive round, and not all applications are going to make the cut this time, but then there's the opportunity to say, well, wait a second, these are really good applications with good projects. That's where people have the opportunity to emphasize those points, maybe more so than the Smart Scale process itself, which is more of a quantitative, plug your numbers in, it's just like numbers. Maybe after that, what we really want to be able to point to those good distillations flesh out the true extent of benefits of this.
Yeah, the silver lining, if we get less than we vote or not get anything or something, is we kind of end up taking the best ones and we can then speed it up, and refocus and emphasize differently.
I'm wondering too, I mean, given, I'm just thinking about, like, Go Virginia and how the state is established, you know, the governor's office, a real focus and emphasis on multi-jurisdictional collaboration. And so this is part of that. This is really taking that seriously. And I know it's part, we just were mentioning it before, but I do think there's something pretty unique about this. This is really in keeping with the change in philosophy at the governor's level, at the state level, of multi-jurisdictional cooperation. And we're taking a gamble, putting this thing in there as not getting any extra points for that, and literally in smart scale, but it does seem to be in keeping with the ethos of the state. So I'm not sure, maybe just referencing other state initiatives that have always stressed multi-jurisdictional approaches. And the only one that comes to mind is Go Virginia.
Any other comments? I've listed six or eight things that my Anthony and all of the things that I'm sure we'll have an opportunity to hear.
Do we ever have anything in these projects that actually quantifies the potential economic gain? I'm just wondering about this.
No, that's a whole different kind of
thing. Yeah. Okay. Because you can imagine, you know, the build-out scenario is going to have a major transformation about.
Yeah, there are definitely ways to do that.
That's maybe later.
Yeah, that's
outside scope. We were just looking at those the other day, Kathy, and what's happening out there.
And you like it before and after? So you, oh wow, interesting. Okay, well, we can talk about that in our meetings.
You know, Paul's point about consider this kind of the first taking of the test, I think it may be good to insert something along those lines at the very end. I mean, the report coming to ends, the last paragraph talks about the smart scale process to complete February 2019. Once the scoring is complete, the CTV will review the results. It's sort of just an abrupt end. And so I do think it, you know, if that doesn't result in funding, it might be nice to have this note of we can use those results to, if it doesn't result in funding, to determine what tweaks to the grouping of projects or any of the projects themselves may be necessary to maximize
I don't want to give them the idea that this is not going to be funded at all.
Yeah, but I mean, just so it doesn't like cut off. Well, you do get funding, all of this can throw it out because I don't think we want to leave, you know, have the report leave that impression if that's the result of this.
Because we want to leave the impression, you could have a better ending to this, I believe.
Yeah, maybe
somehow.
It could be something like it's a long term goal of the region to implement a plan such as this.
We see it as economic development.
It's a way for us to provide affordable housing, bring back some of the elements of the land use plan.
Yeah.
This is access.
Affordable housing, economic
development.
This
is access to.
Yeah, I think those are
opportunity.
A more powerful.
Yeah, we need a
inclusion rather than just that.
And maybe looking at how the land use plan ended, because there was a lot of that idea of increasing housing, increasing jobs, increasing access to both. For all modes of transportation, this is their equitable, sustainable, viable project.
And you might tie in there something about the community that is really providing transit, bike, and pedestrian access to this very specific area that we don't have before.
Stratton is always excluded.
And you could really write a little paragraph.
To borrow some words from Paul Perdue, we really want this conclusion to soar.
We won't let you.
Well, Paul's a pilot, so he's used to
soar. Oh, there you go.
I don't think he's a glider pilot, but he is a licensed pilot. Soaring.
I'm soaring.
He soars more than most of us.
That means my engine cut out, that's not.
Oh dear.
That's it.
Yes, my engine.
Okay, well, this is great input, so is that what we're looking for today? Okay, so.
Better than parachute.
Next steps. Completing and validating smart scale applications, we'll finalize the transportation report, and Chuck's suggesting with all the things that we've made notes of today, we'll note in the track changes document so you can see what has been changed from the version that you saw last. And we'll do all that and get your comments again and finalize before we submit. So I think the next slide will tell us that it's 29th we're supposed to be doing that thing.
You know, before you get that last bullet, just it's quite possible that the scoring team will come back and ask us questions. And that's okay. If we want, that'd be great if they're interested enough.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, so we'll let everyone know, Greg will send out a note or something.
Please.
Yeah,
we want to know every step of the way.
What are they saying?
And refresh my memory, I said the 29th. What, from our last meeting, the submittal date is before the end of July, is it the 29th?
Technically, it's August 1st.
August 1st is final call.
To hit the clearinghouse, you know. But that just makes everyone real nervous, so yeah, the end of the month.
We don't wait till then, no.
The other thing I would just ask, because I found this a very agreeable document, which was really nice. It wasn't full jargon that was hard to understand. Once we have a final copy or a final, I don't want to say final draft, but a final copy, is there, will it be uploaded somewhere where actually our community could look at it and see it?
Well, that's a good question. I'm not sure if it'll be uploaded as a standalone document, because the plan is to integrate it with the small area land use plan.
Yes.
And it's going to be in there, and Sal is making provisions to incorporate it.
Perfect.
Once it's finalized.
Perfect.
So are you asking if we can put it as a standalone document posted somewhere?
I'd like for
in addition to.
It's not hard to do.
I'd like for the community to be able to, if somebody asks Kathy or Morgan or me or something about it, we could say you can find the final product. It's going to smart scale.
I would just want to have a cover page that says this is part of a larger document.
Yes.
Here's a link if you want to see.
So basically, what is going to smart scale application? Is it the whole plan? Is the hydraulics modular plan with this in it, or is it just the transportation plan?
The whole plan.
What
goes to smart scale?
You can do both. It's just, I mean. Either way, we've got to have the transportation piece.
Yeah.
And you can put the whole thing in.
That hurts.
I think we should put the whole thing in.
A lot of times they'll look at, they have to pull pieces out of the plan and they want those pieces readily available and have it go through
sure.
The whole document, define one page out of the document.
But if our transportation plan is citing and referencing a hydraulic small area plan, it needs to be a link to that hydraulic plan.
We can upload the whole thing. Right? It could be something we can talk to. Chip and maybe the good house on the other.
Yeah. It just seems nice that what place to refer people to go to actually see.
But I do think the story is that it's integrated, which is pretty powerful.
Yeah, that's very important because we did not, in the transportation element, did not retell certain things like this panel exists because it was told in the bigger number.
Yeah.
So it has to be
connected. Yeah.
Very good. Well, I think that concludes our business.
Wow. What are we going to do on Thursday
afternoon? Yeah.
Well, I think the statement from my perspective, I just would like to share a thank you to the panel for putting all the time and effort into this. It's really been truly a great process. My involvement started late in the game. I think the real hard work came before I came in, so I sent a note to Chip to thank him for all what I thought made my job a lot easier. Not a small bit, but thank you very much. I know how much time you put into this. And John, of course, we couldn't be here today, but we all appreciate very much the work that you all have done and the interest with which you have done it. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, I just, again, speaking on behalf of the city council, this has been a phenomenal project, and the expertise that you've all shown, both consultant and VDOT, and commitment and passion for this, has just really been gratifying. And I think the willingness to work with our local governments, too, has been also revealing. Not the big state agency that just blows through, and it's going to be our way or the highway, it's going to be fun. No, this has been extremely sensitive and a partnership. So thank you very, very much. And I've just been in awe of your expertise and your professionalism. So it's much appreciated.
I just want to piggyback on Kathy's statement. Somebody asked me, what do you think about the project? I'm like, if you really want to measure the success of the community engagement process, you should have been a planning commission in the city council. I've never been to the adoption process of a project like this, where you don't get a lot of comments, mostly negative from the public regarding the process. The planning commission meeting, the engagement process was well informed, you know, related to the planning commission and the 2-1 in the city council. So as the document made its way to the planning commission and city council, you know, the adoption process was quick. Even city council, I think by the time we got to them, they really analyzed, you know, the major components of the project, and they weren't, they didn't want to listen to the presentation, I don't know, so
that's true.
Yeah, yeah. It took 5 minutes for council to take action on it. So I really,
that work session
was pretty good. And I want to thank Craig and Leha, you know, for their last back and forth for council adoption. You know, it was in fact, the document wouldn't work in terms of printing it. I had to load it on the flash drive and hand deliver it to our office.
Oh, wow.
So I appreciate the coordination.
I just would echo everything that's said here, and I look forward to getting back together to celebrate the fun day.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Speaking of funding, Chuck, anything you can tell us about how things are going on the smart scale?
It's one we're waiting for. I mean, these final edits that you guys are doing, I think we're working with LMD and Calamari, we're working with those on flushing out the finalizing cost estimates and making sure we got everything right. And then we'll pass them on to the MPO who are actually submitting the applications and doing the information. Biggest thing I think we need to look at is make sure we're getting enough economic development information so that we can include it in the application.
Oh, okay.
And that's going to be the biggest thing that we need, because that's going to be a major component on getting scored for this project. So
you do need to use a number of questions in the score.
Well, for that part.
Yeah.
We need to make sure we get as many points as we can.
Yeah.
Anything you guys can share with us?
Sure.
In that regard, pass on to Jacob.
Okay.
Who's doing the application, and we can include the application. We're going to basically get with your application and probably take care of it.
Submitted and approved site plans within a 3-mile, not radius, but 3-mile driving distance.
I mean, if you can get a property that's not developed too, they just don't do as many things.
So you can send that.
Anything that you guys can provide, so I thought you were walking in, and that's where
we're
going.
Good.
Yeah, that's great.
Do we need to give that message to the county tomorrow as well?
I've already reached out to Kevin, but I've talked to him a couple of times. So we can follow up.
Great. So I think everybody's going to be eager to get everything they can to you.
Yeah. Tomorrow my radio is great. It's because it's grade separation.
Yeah.
Grade separation,
grade didn't change.
Goes out 3 miles. It was just a scale on the type of improvement. So.
Okay.
got a thought. We talked earlier about the reviewers might be intimidated by a very large document and having to drill down and find something. That's why, even if we have the whole plan uploaded, which I think we should, we should have the transportation section uploaded, yes.
Right.
I think, could you pull out a few pages about this panel and separate it, even though it's in the big, because that's really unique. This is not a very common process at all. Just to get credit for that, think about that. It might only be a two-page.
That's a process that was for both by them.
Yeah, right.
That's a good idea, though, to separate it out so people can see it easily.
Yeah, and they still might not look deeply in that big document, land use document. Maybe go into the executive something.
I think that's a real thing.
I just wanted to add what you're kind of summarizing. And I said similar comments at the end of the Riot panel, but they hold just as true this time. And this whole process, I think, is brilliant. I think it's a big part of the reason why we've all been able to come together and reach consensus and do so in such a continual manner. But it takes really good people to make even a brilliant design process work. And so, you know, I want to thank all of my panel members for putting aside differences and working together as a team. But just as important, I want to thank all of you, as Kathy said, for the, not just for the expertise you brought to the table, but for the way you took the time to just kind of spell things out, communication with us, and we were throwing new ideas at you. Cool. So you guys are a huge part of the reason we're successful today. Thanks to all of you.
Yeah.
You never look terrified.
That's an interrogation training. Yeah, that's right.
Very
good. Well, thank you, everybody.
Yes.
Much appreciated. We'll be back in touch with the revised report and obviously updates on progress.
So we're officially disbanded.
We are.
Right. So now we can meet as many as we want at one time. Thank you very much, Ray. Really,
okay.
Much appreciated.
I'm glad you come in. And
kept us informed. You've all been very well.
I've got like a backup quarterback.
Maintain quality control.
You don't have a backup quarterback.